Good evening, and welcome to the Deadline Club Awards Ceremony, our signature event recognizing the best in New York journalism. My name is Claire Regan, and it's my privilege to serve as club president. We're sorry we can't be together in person this year. Under the gold chandeliers and dramatic tapestries of the historic Harvard Club of New York City, our traditional venue. The public health crisis has changed this evening's format, but not its mission: to honor the best and the brightest journalists in the New York metropolitan area, where competition is fierce and a prize like our unique Rube statuette represents top achievement in the industry. The Deadline Club is the New York City chapter of the Society of Professional Journalists, founded in 1909 as a fraternity. The Society's motto at the time was, "He serves best who serves the truth." Both the national and local organizations accepted only male journalists as members, until 50 years ago when that rule was abolished and female journalists were able to finally enjoy full membership. The Deadline Club's first female president was elected in 1981, and we've been smashing the glass ceiling ever since. I'm proudly serving my third consecutive term as president of a board rich in diversity, dedication, and talent. Our home base is the historic Selma Gundy Club on Fifth Avenue near Washington Square. We're looking forward to gathering there in person again when we can. These are tough times for journalists. We face challenges to press freedoms guaranteed by the Constitution, assaults on our profession from the highest office in the land, racial unrest, and a global pandemic. Since the time this country was born, American journalists have been the eyes and ears of every citizen, the watchdogs holding the powerful accountable, the voices for the voiceless. There's no stopping us now, in spite of the challenges. It's our duty and our privilege to forge ahead. We need organizations like SPJ today more than ever for solidarity, support, and sustainability. We hope you will consider becoming a member of the club. We sponsor skill-building events, panel discussions about issues affecting our livelihood, and social mixers for networking. During the pandemic, we've assisted fellow journalists in need with a helping hand fund. Follow us on Twitter at Deadline Club, on Facebook, or at deadlineclub.org to keep up with our activities and events. We'll also be tweeting our awards announcements tonight in real time. Here's our club's contact information. Please, let's all stay in touch. And now for the scholarship portion of our program, I'd like to introduce George Bedarkey, Deadline Club Vice President and a member of the Scholarship Committee.
If you want to be inspired about the future of journalism, I mean blown away inspired, read through the applications for the Deadline Club Scholarship. So many students in the New York metropolitan region are producing meaningful journalism. They're uncovering the truth and providing a voice for underrepresented populations. Their work is having a profound impact, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing where their journalistic journeys take them to next. Tonight, we honor five individuals, two undergraduates and three graduate students with $2,500 Deadline Club scholarships. We begin with our undergraduate winners. Natalie Migliori is a 2020 graduate from Fordham University. She's a native New Yorker. Natalie says she's been in love with news radio ever since her first cut copy for WFUV, reporting on pedestrian plazas in Times Square.
I chose a career in journalism because I loved writing and I loved people and I wanted to combine the two. And thanks to the Deadline Club, I actually can afford to pay off some student loans that I've accrued while pursuing my career in journalism at Fordham. So very thankful and grateful for that.
Natalie Rash is a rising senior at Hunter College with a double major in journalism and Africana and Puerto Rican Latino studies. Rash writes for her school's student-run news site, where she's reported on student life during the coronavirus pandemic. She hopes to attend graduate school in New York and pursue a career in entertainment journalism and arts and culture reporting.
Thanks to the Deadline Club scholarship, I'm able to fully realize my goals as a journalism student and hopefully continue my studies in graduate school to pursue journalism further than I have already.
Moving on now to our graduate student winners. Remy Bahati is a graduate student at Columbia University's School of Journalism. She also works as a U.S. correspondent for different television stations in Africa, providing coverage for both anticipated and breaking news. Remy started her journalism career in Uganda at NBS Television, where she worked as a senior political and investigative reporter, unearthing stories about corruption, human rights abuse, and poor service delivery.
The Deadline Club Scholarship means a lot to me as a journalist from Africa. It gives me the opportunity to attend my dream university, Columbia University, to pursue my Master of Science in Journalism. And this dream wouldn't have come true if there were no patrons like you out there to support us. So it means the whole world. I'll gain skills, I'll sharpen my abilities as a journalist, and I'm very proud to be the recipient of this scholarship this year.
Kevin Trong is a documentary photographer, filmmaker, and journalist. He's written for NBC News and Vice and has covered a wide range of topics, including the aftermath of the mass shooting at Pulse nightclub, the LGBTQ movement in Vietnam, and the construction of a Japanese garden at a maximum security prison in Oregon. He's currently pursuing a master's degree in journalism at the Craig Newmark Graduate School of Journalism at CUNY.
I chose a career in journalism because I'm really interested in people and I love hearing their stories. And for me, it's just such a joy to go out there in the streets and meet people and hear their insight into how their lives are going. And I think there's a lot we can do with their stories, from building an empathy to also building an understanding of one another. I think that's something that we need. And I want to really thank you for this Deadline Club scholarship. It's so helpful. When I got the news, I had the biggest smile on my face. It's just one less thing that I have to worry about. This funding and the connections that I'll get through the scholarship mean the world to me. And thank you so much for seeing the potential in my work. And I'll do my best to make you proud.
Kimon de Grief is a freelance journalist from South Africa, now studying at NYU. He's written for the New York Times, The Guardian, The Atlantic, National Geographic, and others, as well as co-authored a book on the underworld of abalone poaching in collaboration with a poacher who began writing his life story in jail.
I'm very curious about the world. I love a professional reason to ask questions of people. I also like the idea that my work might make an impact and have some meaning in the world. I'm going to be pursuing several freelance stories that I'm really excited about, and I have a bit more liberty to really explore them before getting to the pitching phase. I'm also going to be paying my rent in New York City.
Now I turn things over to my Deadline Club colleague, Katina Perrin, to introduce this year's winner of the Robert Greenman Award for High School Journalism Teaching and Advising.
Thank you, George. Every year since 2006, the Deadline Club honors a high school journalism teacher who excels at managing newsrooms filled with rabble-rousing teens prone to grammatical errors. This year's winner, Rachel Rennick of Eximius College Preparatory Academy, does all that backwards in high heels with extremely limited resources and during a global pandemic. Before we hear from Rachel and her students, I want to tell you a little bit about the late Robert Greenman, for whom this award was named following his passing in 2018. Bob was a longtime member of the Deadline Club and the fiercest advocate for student journalism I ever met. Bob was a wordsmith, an author, and an educator. He literally wrote the book on how to be an outstanding school newspaper advisor. He shared his love of words with thousands of students as an English and journalism teacher at James Madison and Edward R. Murrow High Schools in his home borough of Brooklyn, and as a journalism professor at Kingsborough Community College. He started this important recognition of high school journalism teachers and advisors and spent many hours carefully poring over student newspapers to honor the best of the best in our area. It is only fitting that this important award be named for him. Tonight we honor Rachel Rennick, the advisor of the Nightly News in the Bronx. She started advising and teaching journalism at Pelham Preparatory Academy, where she founded the Panther Press. For the past 6 years, teen reporters at Eximius have been lucky enough to have Rachel at the helm of their newsroom, where they learn valuable lessons about one of the tenets of our democracy. This video, created after her school went remote last spring, will explain why she's being honored with the Greenman Award. Congratulations, Rachel.
Hi, Ms. Rennick. Hi there.
Hi, hello.
What I love most about my nightly news journalists is watching them come alive during a budget meeting. Watching them get so fired up about the articles they want to write or the ones that they're working on, and listening to them bring that energy and share their reasons why they feel we should publish an article. My kids come from the South Bronx, and we are located in the poorest congressional district in the United States of America. And they're finding out what they're passionate about, and they're learning how to use their journalistic tools to be able to make a difference and have a voice in their own lives.
She appealed to me in a way that nobody ever has. Like, she made me believe that. She made me believe in myself.
Something that Ms. Renick has taught me about journalism is that you can do whatever you set your heart to.
And just like, she kept on encouraging me, so that has to be my favorite memory of her.
You can't just wait for things to happen. Of course, they gotta happen at some point. You gotta be ready.
The greatest lesson that Ms. Renick has taught me was to never give up. Things that are too hard and the things that are challenging is what makes us better people. It's what helps to build character.
She really pushes us to do our best. She pushes us to work in that professional setting.
Tonight, we're fortunate to have not one, but two journalists of national famous keynoters. Two journalists who are front and center during this historic election year. Yamiche Alcindor is the White House correspondent for the PBS NewsHour and a political contributor to NBC News and MSNBC. Philip Rucker is an author and the White House bureau chief at the Washington Post. You can be sure both have plenty of insights to share about the current political scene. Deadline Club board member James Martinez, breaking news investigations editor for the Associated Press, will MC tonight's conversation, which we bring you live from Washington, D.C. I'll hand it over to James.
Thanks, Claire. We are indeed honored to have two speakers here today who literally have had a front row seat to the Trump presidency. In keeping with our Deadline Club tradition, our speakers will engage in a lively conversation followed by a brief question and answer session from the audience. You can submit questions via the YouTube or Facebook Live chat function or via Twitter with the hashtag DeadlineAward. So with that, I will turn it over to our speakers from Washington, Yamiche Alcindor and Philip Rucker.
Thanks so much, James. Well, I'm excited to have this conversation with Phil. I feel like we're just kind of talking about our lives and all that we were witnessing. So I know, Phil, you wanted to start with just today. So I'll let you have the first question. I know you wanted to.
Yeah, so it's great to be with you guys. And congratulations, by the way, to the scholarship recipients and the award winners tonight. It's a big honor. And Yamiche and I both wish we could be there with you in person, but that'll have to be another year. You know, the president today was out in California. He's been out west for a couple of days now. He had a briefing on the wildfires that are tearing across that state and across Oregon, Washington state, really devastating huge swaths of the western United States. And he denied the science behind climate change. He was actually asked by a scientist about the changing climate, and the president said he doesn't think the science is always right, and that the climate could be cooling, which of course the scientists there in that briefing disagreed with him on. But it sets up a real clash between him and Joe Biden, because Biden was in Wilmington, Delaware just an hour earlier saying the president is a climate arsonist, and if he's elected to four more years, much more of the country could burn because he has so ignored this urgent issue. What did you make of all of that, Yamiche?
I should say, you also congratulated the scholarship recipients. I remember thinking about, as I was thinking about doing this event, that I was a scholarship recipient and that the Deadline Club has taken care of me and given me support and recognition. So I really also want to say congratulations to them and congratulations to the club in general. I think in terms of what we saw today, in some ways, it was what we expected, because the president, President Trump, has made a career. Part of his foundation as a political figure has been denying climate change, has been rolling back environmental policies. I was shocked, much like I think a lot of people were, to kind of hear the president say, look, it might get cooler, you just wait. I think we all knew, yeah. In some ways, that the president already kind of was not going to be someone who was going to talk about climate change as being proven. But I think to kind of see him out west, when obviously so many communities are burning, was, I think, a reminder that he really is doubling down on this idea that he knows the way forward and that his instincts are that he will continue to deny climate change. And of course, Joe Biden, as a Democrat, we heard so many times before from other Democrats talking about President Trump's views on science. So I wasn't in some ways it's interesting to see, but it also, I think, is really expected. I mean, the terminology climate arsonist is a little interesting to me. What did you think?
It's a big word. I was actually surprised to hear Biden apply that label to President Trump. There was something also rhetorically that Biden did in his remarks in Delaware that really was interesting. He, you know, for weeks now, Trump has been saying that the suburbs across America are going to be over, effectively, in Joe Biden's America, if Biden's elected president, that he'll allow, you know, looters and anarchists and Antifa take over cul-de-sacs everywhere and destroy suburban American life as we know it. That's, of course, hyperbole, but nonetheless, it's the campaign strategy the president's pursuing. And then Biden tried to turn that today in Delaware. He basically said, look, the real threat to the suburbs in America is fire, that suburban communities in California, in Oregon, in Washington, are burning, and people who live in the suburbs out west are afraid that their homes may burn down. And so that was an interesting play by Biden, I thought.
It was an interesting play. And I think in some ways, and I'm interested to hear what you think about this, there's this idea that this is a fear election, as much as it's, of course, about the coronavirus and the pandemic and about race and the racial reckoning and policing. This is really about both men saying, if you elect this other person or re-elect this other person, that life as we know it is going to be endangered, and that the person across the aisle from me, that they are a dangerous figure, both to democracy, but as you said today, and as you pointed out, also to the very existence of people's homes and the communities that they love. What do you make of the way that we've seen fear in particular drive this election?
It's incredible. It's clearly the biggest motivating factor for both bases, for the Democratic base, the fear of Trump, of another 4 years of Trump, fear of America straying from our democracy, from our founding. We heard that message delivered at the Democratic convention last month, and with particular urgency and alarm from President Obama, who said this is not a typical political choice. This is about rescuing our country, saving American democracy. And then we've heard the same type of fear on the right from Trump, from Pence, repeatedly saying that nobody will be safe in Joe Biden's America, trying to scare, in particular, suburban women, in the outskirts of Philadelphia, Milwaukee, some of these other metropolitan areas where Trump is trying to win back support in order to carry those states in the Electoral College. He's playing to fear as well. And I mean, Yamiche, it's been so striking the last few months how much this election is about galvanizing the base, right? Both candidates are focused on how to turn out and motivate their core supporters, because the polling is showing that very few Americans are actually undecided at this point. Most people in this country have a pretty firm opinion of how they think President Trump has done in office. What, Yamiche, what do you think of these last couple of weeks of really bad news for the president, starting with that Jeffrey Goldberg article in The Atlantic, where he's found to have disparaged veterans in a really horrific way, and that reverberated for days. And then last week, we heard the first revelations from Bob Woodward's book, Rage, which actually goes on sale tomorrow. But the audio tapes of the president admitting that he was intentionally misleading the American people about the lethality and severity of the virus. Do you think this is something he recovers from? And what are your sources telling you about what that path looks like?
So I think, like you, I've covered President Trump for several years and watched him weather so many controversies that would have done any other person in, Democrat or Republican. So I think when I look at the things that we've learned in the last couple of weeks, I'm not sure whether or not it hurts him. I know you use the word recover, yeah. But I also wonder whether or not it hurts him at all, because yeah. There's the pandemic raging. Because he's also said things that we just haven't heard an American politician say, thinking about his attacks on John McCain. So of course the Atlantic article was striking in the fact that he didn't want to go see fallen service members overseas. But when you think about it, he also said that he thought John McCain was a loser because he was captured. And the idea that he talked about women grabbing their genitals. He talked about sexual assault. He said that very fine people go to Nazi rallies. There's just been, there's so many people who are connected to the president who are in jail, including his own personal attorney. There's the adult film star scandal, just scandal after scandal after scandal, that I don't know whether or not these two things have a big impact on him, or whether or not they're just going to be part of more of what people see as what he does and the expectations. I've always been struck by, when I talk to Trump supporters, they kind of give President Trump this pass. And I think it has to do partly with maybe the fact that he was a reality TV star and the expectations were low and he was seen as an outsider. He's never held public office before. But my sense is that the standard for President Trump among his own voters are lower than they would be for other people. And I think that that's been a challenge that I've thought of as a reporter for Joe Biden, because I think that people that are voting for Joe Biden, they have such high standards for him. He says something wrong, he has to apologize that same day. Think about when he said, "Black, if you're not black, if you don't vote for President Trump," he had to apologize immediately. And President Trump hardly apologizes at all. So I'm really interested in that. I want to ask you and size up your ideas on the upcoming debates between President Trump and Joe Biden. What do you think is at stake for both candidates? And when you think about the fireworks that we're about to see, have we already kind of seen maybe an inkling of that between the DNC and the RNC? Or do you think we're going to see completely new blows? I'm thinking about the fact of President Trump bringing President Bill Clinton's accusers to that debate. It was a move that I just had never anticipated.
Yeah.
Do you think we're going to see stuff like that one. Maybe? It was very wild.
I am sure that President Trump is going to try to pull some attention-grabbing moment, stunt, if you were, at these debates. It's in his nature. It's sort of his instinct always is for the drama and to try to surprise his opponent. But I actually think the stakes are especially high for Joe Biden in the first debate. And it's not just my opinion. That's what a lot of Democratic analysts and veteran pollsters have told me the last few weeks. They think it all is going to hinge on these debates, because the polling and focus group data continue to show that a number of Americans who voted for Donald Trump in 2016 have soured on him. It's the reason why Democrats were able to win back the House in 2018. And they just need to get comfortable with Biden. And if they can feel like Biden's got it under control, they're gonna end up voting for him in November. And so it's really up to Biden to have a convincing performance in the debate. And if Trump can sort of make Biden perform poorly or get tripped up or say things that he doesn't mean to say or get hot and flustered in a really negative way, that could have a detrimental impact for the Democratic nominee, according to people in his party. And I think it's one of the reasons why the Biden campaign is so focused on these debates. We don't hear a lot about debate preparation, but it's been noteworthy the last week or two how few public appearances Joe Biden has had, which, you know, we've covered politics for some time. If a candidate is down, not doing public events this time of year, it's probably because they're spending some time preparing for those debates. But we don't hear about that kind of debate preparation over on the Trump side of things. You know, and we've got a few more minutes left here to chat. And I just want to ask you, Yamiche, what it's like to do this job every day and to withstand the kind of public pressure that you faced from the president. I've been in the Rose Garden a few times where you've stood up to ask him questions and he will mock you, he will demean you, he'll snap at you. It can get really ugly. And you know, he's that way, the president is that way in a hostile way with a number of other reporters, but he especially seems to have it out for you. And I'm just wondering, how do you sort of keep your chin up? How do you stay professional and calm and composed and get in there every day and do your job?
Well, I'm going to ask you the same question because just this week, or just last week, I should say, I saw you really pressing the president on the Woodward revelations and how he handled this pandemic. So I'm going to ask you the same question, but I'll answer it first, which is, I think for me, being a White House reporter feels like an incredible privilege. And I'm a civil rights reporter. I think by training, by mind, I got into this industry thinking about the civil rights movement and all the stories from the 1960s where Black journalists in particular were going into dangerous situations and telling the stories and exposing the flaws of America. And I'm interested in White House reporting, especially because we're in this moment where civil rights is something that's on everyone's mind. So for me, when I think about the president, when he calls me nasty or kind of gets flustered when I ask him a question, I really think about, okay, but I'm here and we're supposed to be responsible for the people who may never make it into the White House. And like you, I'm sure, I also prepare for my questions so much and am ready to fact check the question. So I think, and I'm ready to fact check to the president in real time. So I think when I see the president lashing out and being angry, in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, I need to respond with facts, respond with what actually happened. And this is not, in some ways, a personal back and forth between me and the president. It's about what the American people want to know. So I want to ask you the same question, which is, how do you prepare to answer, to question the president? And what do you do when you feel this back and forth between the president, especially when a lot of this plays out on live television, which, having been a print reporter, it's an adjustment to me to have these exchanges and to ask questions on live television when you know millions of people are watching.
Yeah, well, Yamiche, I love the way you answered that question, talking about how you're so focused on sort of being there as a representative for people who can't be in the White House and don't have the access to ask the president those questions. That's so important about what we do, what all journalists do. I mean, we're not there for ourselves. We're there to represent the public and to seek truth as an advocate for the public in a way. These briefings are on television. They're literally, by definition, a show. And I think it's so important that we not make it more of a show, that we not play into the president's desire to have this sort of hostile back and forth between reporter and president. I try really hard when I'm in that briefing room or have an opportunity to ask him questions, never to raise my voice. Occasionally I do, and that's just sort of natural human instinct, but I really try to stay calm and to be composed and to stick to my question and the facts. And if he calls me fake news, I'm not going to answer by saying, no, I'm not. I mean, I answer by repeating the question that he had failed to answer, or by correcting a statement that he said wasn't true. Last week in the briefing room, he started to say that the coronavirus cases were so much worse in Europe than they are here in the United States. That's simply not true. And I just said repeatedly, that is not true. That is not true. And you just have to kind of keep him focused on the question, but not get distracted by the sideshow and not create the adversarial clash that he's looking for. Our editor at the Washington Post, Marty Baron, says we should keep in mind, we're not at war with the president, we're at work. And that's sort of been a guiding principle for all seven of us who cover the White House for the Post. And we think about that every time we're interacting with the president.
Well, you do it well. You do it so well.
Oh, well, you do too. So.
All right, this is a great conversation. We have some questions that are coming in the audience. You mentioned the Bob Woodward's book. Do you think it was ethical for him to wait 6 months to reveal that Trump knew the virus was serious, but was intentionally downplaying it? And what about the fact that Woodward, one of our great journalists, was actually taking a side at the end of that book, saying that Trump was not the right choice to be president?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that question, and start by saying Bob Woodward is a friend and a colleague at the Washington Post. I don't speak on his behalf, of course, and he does his book reporting independent from the Washington Post. So he sort of follows his own protocols and procedures. I don't have full visibility into his reporting process for this latest book, Rage, but I do know that he has said that he did not feel that he had an obligation to share this information in real time, in part because it took him many months to sort of report out the full picture of what was known and what was happening at that time One thing I would add is that I too am a co-author of a book, A Very Stable Genius, with Carol Lenig. And when Carol and I set out to report that book about President Trump earlier in the presidency, our editor gave us pretty firm instructions about how to distinguish between what is like the color, the detail, the anecdote that you would learn in the course of reporting for a book that you hold on to for the book. The sort of extra color, that dialogue that really fills out a narrative in book form, and distinguish between that and matters of urgent public concern, things that you might uncover in your reporting for the book that the public really deserves to know quickly and right away. And, you know, I realize that a lot of the interviews that we do for books are for books, and sources will tell us things that they may not tell us for our reporting for the daily paper, because they know it's going to be put into a historical context and in a longer term project. But if we uncovered things in the course of book reporting, and Carol and I did in a couple instances, that we felt the public needed to know, we found a way with our sources to bring that to light and to get it published in the paper.
Good. We have another question about the upcoming presidential election and how it might be playing out with so much talk of fraud and mail-in issues. Are you worried that some outlets might call the election too fast? And what should we as journalists be looking out for on election night?
I'll say at PBS NewsHour, one thing that we've been really careful to do is to try to start preparing our viewers for the idea that election might not mean that we will know who's the next president of the United States, or who, or whether or not President Trump gets reelected, because we're probably going to see an unprecedented, even though that word is so overused, we're going to see an unprecedented number of people who are voting by mail. So that means that there could be days, if not weeks, of counting in different states and counties. So I think that in some ways, it's just really important to get people used to the idea that while we might get a result the day of the election, I think most news organizations are going to be very, very cautious about how they report who the winner is. I also think, going back to the 2000 Florida election, being a Floridian myself, I think that we all learned some really critical lessons. And I think going forward, I'm hoping that we won't be calling elections too early, but I don't even know if you would call what happened in Florida, of course, calling counting too early, because that was, of course, a completely wild situation in and of itself. But I think that we could have to buckle up for what happens in November, because I think this is going to be an election like we've never seen before, especially because there are already people saying that there are moves within the Trump administration to try to stifle people voting by mail. And there are people who are willing to possibly wait in line for at least hours, full days, maybe into the next day if we have to.
Well, excellent. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. Thank you so much for a very interesting discussion. We'll just have to see how it plays out. It's going to be an interesting one. Now let's proceed with the presentation of our Deadline Club Awards, made by our own Betsy Ashton.
Thank you, Yamiche, Alcindor, and Phil Rucker, for joining us and for the excellent work that you do every day. It's truly an honor to have you with us. I'm Betsy Ashton, past president and longtime board member of the Deadline Club, and your awards MC for the remainder of the evening. But first, as we come together to celebrate great journalism, let's take a moment to recognize those in our field whom we've lost this year. Here are the masters of our craft who have recently passed on.
Thank you.
2019. What a news year it was. We heard, we saw, we read about all of it because intrepid journalists like you watching were there to cover the news and to tell it to the world. Tonight, we celebrate the best work created by journalists based in the New York area. A word, however, about the fact that we are not all gathered at the Harvard Club in stunning Harvard Hall and seated to a glorious celebratory dinner. No. You're all at home looking, I hazard a guess, considerably more slovenly than you have in your finest business attire, sprawled out on the sofa wearing sweats, was it the morning or the evening pair? You know, flip-flops dangling from your toes, right? With a beer or something even more potent in hand, I hope. You are the veritable portrait of a pandemic, at least the part of it that's outside the emergency room or the ICU. But we are gathered electronically, as it may be, to celebrate superb work that needs to be celebrated. We're going to pretend that you're all here. So I put my hair up, got the pearls out, and, you know, I'm blessed to be here in beautiful Andrew Hall in St. Thomas Church, Fifth Avenue, for the occasion. We thank the rector and the staff for welcoming us here. And I dare say, there are far more of you watching than the 220 or so that we normally squeeze into Harvard Hall. So let's get started honoring great journalism. Here's how we do it. To keep the flavor of our regular awards presentation, I will begin by announcing the finalists in each category. We all will applaud each one in a very special way. We're going to applaud each one, you at home, and the small team here with me. Every one of you will get the clap. Yes, that's what I said. And here's how it works. One clap for everything. One really good clap. We're going to practice right now. Are you ready? One, two, three, clap. That's good. All right, I will then announce the winner or the winners whom you can clap for a bit longer. They will receive our very special statue designed by the late, great Rube Goldberg. Yes, that Rube Goldberg, who crafted his truly unique idea of a deadline. I will also share with you the comments from our judges as to why they made the selection they did, and we'll then move on to the next category. Now, you're going to be happy to know that in the interest of time and because we have so many to honor, there are no acceptance speeches. Now, a special word to all you finalists. You are in a very distinguished group. We had 689 entries this year, so just to make the cut was a truly fierce competition. So if you received an invitation to be a part of this event, if you were named as a finalist, it means you did extraordinary, excellent work. Accept the applause, the clap in this case, and enjoy it, even if you don't win the Rube. I'm not just saying this. It happens to be true that at this level of competition, it's often the subject matter, or being in the right place at the right time, or dodging a bullet, something that you totally cannot control, that makes one piece stand out among excellent entries. All of you finalists deserve and are here for recognition. I repeat, you are being honored for doing truly outstanding work. So let's get started. The first categories are for newspapers, wire services, and digital news. Newspaper and digital beat reporting. And the finalists are Christopher Bing and Joel Scheckman of Reuters for Project Raven. M.B. Pell and Joshua Schneier of Reuters for Ambushed at Home. Michael Spies of The Trace and The New Yorker for Secrecy, Self-Dealing, and Greed at the NRA. Congratulations to all for excellent work. The judges picked Christopher Bing and Joel Scheckman of Reuters for Project Raven. They wrote, through exclusive access to cybersecurity insiders and sensitive internal documents, Cyberbeat reporters Chris Bing and Joel Scheckman uncovered the murky, hard-to-penetrate underworld of exported state surveillance. Their reporting brought to light a troubling trend that undermines national security from abroad and empowers oppressive world leaders. Congratulations for excellent work. Moving on to newspaper or digital feature reporting. The finalists are Essay Olumhens of The City for 20 years after killing of Amadou Diallo, What's Changed? Evan Ratliff of The Insider for the story of Jamal Khashoggi's murder and how the world looked the other way. Ryan Devereaux of The Intercept for Bodies in the Borderland. Congratulations to all, superb work. The judges picked Ryan Devereaux of The Intercept for Bodies in the Borderland. And they wrote, superlative storytelling, strong reporting and writing, supported by evocative and industry-leading photography, and elucidated with a video feature. Important topic, a well-balanced story creatively and exhaustively covered. Congratulations. Moving on now to newspaper or digital spot news reporting. The finalists are Ari Feldman, Jordan Kitsuk, Helen Chernikoff, and Irene Katz Connolly of The Forward for Violent Attack Upends Years of Quiet, Happy Growth in Jersey City's Hasidic Haven. Larry Salona of The New York Post for Jeffrey Epstein's Suicide. Gabriella Borter and Daniel Trotta of Reuters for New York Officer Fired, But Tensions Still High, Where Eric Garner Died. Congratulations to all, excellent work. The winner, Ari Feldman, Jordan Kutzuk, Helen Chernikoff, and Irene Katz Connolly of The Forward for Violent Attack Upends Years of Quiet in Jersey City's Hasidic Haven. Congratulations. The judges wrote, very engaging story, wonderful context and detail, great storytelling style, and beautifully done for a same-day deadline. The coverage made one judge feel like she could envision daily life in the community. Moving on now to newspaper or digital enterprise reporting, the finalists are Rima Amin of Chalkbeat, New York, for Exposed to Lead as a Baby, Bishop Now Struggles in School. Could an evaluation used in Flint help New York City students like him? Sarah Butemowitz and Meredith Kolodner of The Hechinger Report and NBC News Digital for They Just Saw Me as a Dollar Sign. How some certificate schools profit from vulnerable students. Melissa Jeltson, Amanda Kippert, and Tara Hale of HuffPost for A Forgotten Crisis. Congratulations all, excellent work. And the winner, Rima Amin of Chalkbeat, New York for Exposed to Lead as a Baby, Bishop Now Struggles in School. Could an evaluation used in Flint help New York City students like him? The judges wrote, Amin's story breathed new life into a subject by showing the impacts later in a child's life and by doggedly pursuing solutions for how those impacts could have been, could still be mitigated for children who suffer from the effects of lead exposure. At a time when parents and educators all over the world are dealing with a crisis for which they were wholly unprepared, this story provides a model for addressing a crisis with compassion and commitment to uncovering a path forward. Congratulations. Moving on now to newspaper or digital local news reporting. The finalists are Chip Rowe of The Highlands Current for The Extremist Next Door. Thomas Meyer of Newsday for An Innocent Man. Brian M. Rosenthal of the New York Times for Taken for a Ride. Congratulations all, excellent work. And the winner is Brian M. Rosenthal of the New York Times for Taken for a Ride, and here's why. The judges said, amazing use of public records. Brian Rosenthal connects the dots thanks to interviews, 450 of them, a database that records every medallion sale since 1995, and the painstaking review of thousands of loan documents. Great graphics show how the price of medallions rose and then crashed. Wow. Truly, truly original reporting. Congratulations. Super work. Next we have reporting by a newspaper with circulation under 100,000. And the finalists are Andrew Ford of the Asbury Park Press for Policing the Police, Exposing Deadly Chases, Lying Cops, and Gender Discrimination in New Jersey Law Enforcement. Thomas Zambito of the Journal News, LoHUD.com, for The Nuclear Option, Core of the Matter. And Dustin Racioppi of The Record, NorthJersey.com, for Schools Development Authority. Congratulations to all. Super work. And the winner? Andrew Ford of the Asbury Park Press for Policing the Police, Exposing Deadly Chases, Lying Cops, and Gender Discrimination in New Jersey Law Enforcement. Congratulations for superb work. Here's why the judges picked it. They said, policing the police is an example of what we all aspire to as journalists, unrelenting reporting, follow through, and smart collaboration. All of these factors created a series of important personal stories of systemic failures, the recipe for true impact. The judges especially want to recognize the Asbury Park Press collaboration with the College of New Jersey for pieces in this series. Wonderful work. Now we have reporting by independent digital media. And the finalists are Annabelle Peavy, Neela Banerjee, and Adrian Briscoe of Inside Climate News for American Climate, the Shared Experience of Disaster. Anna Flagg, Christy Thompson, Andrew R. Calderon, and Julia Preston of The Marshall Project for Crime and Deportation, shining a light on the myths that drive our immigration system. Josh DeZeza of The Verge for In Amazon's Shadow, the unseen workers, entrepreneurs, and hustlers who stock Amazon's shelves. Congratulations to all for excellent work. The judges picked Annabelle Peavy, Neela Banerjee, and Adrian Briscoe of Inside Climate News for American Climate, the Shared Experience of Disaster. Congratulations. Here's why they picked it. Everybody reports disaster stories, they wrote, but Inside Climate News went beyond the death and destruction to starkly show readers how a California wildfire, a Gulf Coast hurricane, and Midwestern flooding were connected. Enhanced with videos and graphics, the shared experience of disaster paints a multifaceted picture of the effects of climate change on the planet, making it all the more real and powerful testimony from survivors. Now we move on to magazines. And we have first the category of magazine personal service. The finalists are Leslie Goldman, Amy Brightfield, and Stephen Orr of Better Homes and Gardens for What Someone with Depression Wants You to Know. Esme Dupre of Bloomberg Businessweek for Sunburned, What Happened When I Bought a House with Solar Panels. And Jess Pels and Andrea Stanley of Cosmopolitan for How to Go to Rehab. Congratulations to all for superb work. The judges picked Esme Dupre of Bloomberg Business Week for Sunburned, and here's what they wrote. Bloomberg Business Week Sunburned. What happened when I bought a house with solar panels by Esme E. Dupre is gracefully written and thoroughly researched. The writer unravels a complex financial puzzle in a way that makes it understandable, compelling, and timely in light of a new California mandate affecting millions of homes, and gives her personal story an evergreen universality in this era of climate change. Congratulations, wonderful work. Moving on now to magazine profile. The finalists are Jessica Pels and Andrea Stanley of Cosmopolitan for The Savant. Next, Kayla Webley Adler of Marie Claire for Mother, Doctor, Wife, Addict. And Jaime Ducharme of Time for The Face of Change. Congratulations to all. Excellent work. The judges picked Jaime Ducharme of Time for The Face of Change. And here's what they wrote. The Face of Change presents the compelling portrait of Robert Chelsea, the first African-American to receive a full-face transplant. Jaime Ducharme combines thorough reporting with a keen eye for detail and economically but wonderfully evocative writing, providing a vivid, skillfully rendered profile. The story balances an engaging narrative with a well-supported discussion of long-standing disparities in medical care. It opens a unique and revealing window on the push for racial equality in all aspects of contemporary American life. Congratulations, superb work. We move on now to magazine investigative reporting. And the finalists are Anna Edney, Susan Burfield, and Margaret Newkirk of Bloomberg Business Week for Tainted Pills, Broken Trust. Rachel Rabkin Peachman, Joel Keen, Jen Schechter, Margaret Gilman, and Andy Bergman of Consumer Reports for The Rise and Fall of Inclined Sleepers. And Sharon Gunyup, Steve Winter, and Riley Champagne of National Geographic for The Tigers Next Door. Congratulations all. The judges picked Rachel Rabkin Peachman, Joel Keen, Jen Schechter, Margaret Gilman, and Andy Bergman of Consumer Reports for The Rise and Fall of Inclined Sleepers. Congratulations. Here is what the judges wrote. Consumer Reports' groundbreaking investigation brought to light how a product that parents trusted to keep babies safely sleeping was actually responsible for at least 70 deaths and more than 1,000 incidents and injuries. It reflects the best of investigative journalism, with clear, concise, and sensitive reporting, in-depth research, and a dedication to publishing findings despite legal challenges. Wonderful work. Now moving on to magazine feature reporting. The finalists are Sharon Gynup, Steve Winter, and Riley Champagne of National Geographic for The Tigers Next Door. Emily Rabiteau of New York Review of Books for Climate Signs. Andy Greenberg of Wired for The Untold Story of the 2018 Olympics Cyber Attack, the most deceptive hack in history. Congratulations all. The judges picked Emily Rabiteau of the New York Review of Books for Climate Signs. Congratulations. The judges wrote, though the entire category consisted of many, many strong entries, this particular feature was a unique standout. The author provides a compelling view into the anxieties and fears about the future that will be left to generations beyond our own. Portrayed through a journey of rediscovery of the bonds that connect us to each other as humans and the surroundings which we inhabit, but take for granted in the daily grind of life, particularly in these troubled times. The fear and anxiety expressed by the author over the impact that natural and biologic forces far beyond our control are only intensified by society's indifference and inaction in mitigation efforts. And now for the specialized writing categories, we have arts reporting, and the finalists are Simi Horowitz of The Hollywood Reporter for Marriage Story and the Evolution of the Divorce Film. Peter Moss of The Intercept for A Prize for Lies. Joe Coscarelli and Milena Mrazek of The New York Times for Ryan Adams' Dangled Success, Women Say They Paid a Price. Congratulations to all for excellent work. The winner is Peter Moss of The Intercept. The winner is Peter Moss of The Intercept for A Prize for Lies. Congratulations. The judges said, The Intercept series on Peter Handke's Nobel Prize was both an investigative achievement and an instructional explainer on a confusing and complicated controversy. The stories reveal the moral failures and cracked judgment of the Nobel judging process. The reporter also enhanced the stories with his firsthand experiences of covering the conflict in Bosnia. Excellent work. Moving on to sports reporting. The finalists are Baxter Holmes of ESPN.com for These Kids Are Ticking Time Bombs, The Threat of Youth Basketball. Natalie Wiener of SB Nation for The Line of Fire. Ben Reiter of Sports Illustrated for The Hate Magnet. Congratulations to all. Excellent work. The judges picked Baxter Holmes of ESPN.com for These Kids Are Ticking Time Bombs, The Threat of Youth Basketball. Congratulations. The judges wrote, This story is comprehensive, well-researched, and told from multiple perspectives. It tackles a big issue through the lives of participants at every level, whether they are famous or not. It brings us the human side of the sport, not just what is seen on the highlight reels, with great interviews and reporting. Well done. Moving on to business feature, the finalists are Erica Fry of Fortune for Epidemic of Fear. Virginia Eubanks, The Guardian US and the Economic Hardship Reporting Project for Zombie Debts Are Hounding Struggling Americans. Will you be next? And Marcus Stern, Pat Maddox, Kate Parker, and Charlotte Kessel of The Weather Channel and weather.com for Harvest, Recovery and Risk After Hurricane Michael. Congratulations to all. The judges picked Erica Fry of Fortune for Epidemic of Fear. Congratulations, wonderful work. The judges wrote, A deep dive into how corporate and public policy missteps and anti-vax paranoia sank an effort at a dengue fever vaccine. Its lessons have new relevance as the world races to find a vaccine for COVID-19. Next, we have business investigative reporting, and the finalists are the staff of Bloomberg News for Alexa's Listeners, Catherine Blunt, Russell Gold, and Rebecca Smith of The Wall Street Journal for How PG&E Burned California, and Nancy Solomon, Jeff Pilitz, Michael Mishak, David Lewis, and Marilyn Thompson of WNYC and ProPublica for The Real Bosses of New Jersey. Congratulations to all for excellent work. The judges picked Catherine Blunt, Russell Gold, and Rebecca Smith of The Wall Street Journal for How PG&E Burned California. Congratulations. Here's what they wrote. This is a strong look at corporate failings that led to widespread public health and safety issues and death. well-documented, thoroughly reported, and cleanly written. Investigative journalism at its best holds the powerful accountable. This look at a public utility impacting hundreds of thousands of residents fits the bill. Well done. Moving on now to science, technology, medical, and environmental reporting, the finalists are Erica Fry and Fred Schulte of Fortune and Kaiser Health News for Death by a Thousand Clicks. Carolyn Chen of ProPublica for Heartless Hospital. Matt Sandy of Time for The Amazon Rainforest is Nearly Gone. We went to the front lines to see if it could be saved. Congratulations to all. Wonderful work. The judges picked Carolyn Chen of ProPublica for Heartless Hospital. Congratulations. And here's why. They wrote, in the transplant files, ProPublica reporter Carolyn Chen's investigative reporting exposes how well-intended federal rules based on one-year organ transplant survival rates can create perverse incentives. It's a haunting series weaving in vivid details about patients and their families. After exposing families in an important New Jersey hospital's beloved transplant center, Chen's reporting led to local outrage that helped some families recover from very unethical treatment that had occurred at the worst moments of their lives. It also sparked multiple state and federal investigations, which had led to an ongoing plan of correction at the hospital. Very strong work. Congratulations. Now we move on to opinion writing. And the finalists, only two of them made the cut this year. We have Andrea Pitzer of the New York Review of Books for Some Suburb of Hell, America's New Concentration Camp System. And Stuart A. Thompson, Charlie Warzel, and Alex Kingsbury of the New York Times for One Nation Tracked. Congratulations to all. The judges picked Stuart A. Thompson, Charlie Warzel, and Alex Kingsbury of the New York Times for One Nation Tracked. Congratulations. Here's what they wrote. In revealing how the location tracking industry monitors and memorizes our every movement, the New York Times convincingly shows the risks of our reliance upon mobile devices and the need for tougher privacy protection regulations. A masterly effort combining the best of investigative and opinion journalism, skillfully presented online and in print. Well done. And now for the photography categories. We get to see the entries. Spot News Photo. Dew, Nali O'Cherry, and Rebecca Blackwell of the Associated Press did Haiti, Nation on the Brink. Matthew Abbott of the New York Times presented Wildfire. And Evgenia Arbugeva of Time did Greta Thunberg Meets the Press. Congratulations all for wonderful shots. The judges picked Matthew Abbott of the New York Times for Wildfire. Congratulations. The judges wrote, up close and personal, photographer Matthew Abbott literally and figuratively captures the intensity of the catastrophic brush fires that devastated Lake Conjoli, Australia in 2019. The moment is impeccably preserved in color, composition, and movement. We feel the desperation, the urgency, and the anxiety, not only of the kangaroo, but of an entire nation and the world. Wonderful work. Moving on now to sports photo. Our finalists are Alex Brandon of the Associated Press for Offensive Guard. Jason Potterton, Julianne Verace, and Joe Amon of ESPN for Amanda Nunes, and J. Conrad Williams of Newsday for Head Over Heels. Congratulations to all wonderful, wonderful photos. The winner, J. Conrad Williams of Newsday for Head Over Heels. Well, congratulations. The judges wrote, "This photo takes the viewer into a real and unique moment of competition. The angles are exceptional, as are the facial expressions. The photo captures the literally gripping and physical nature of high school wrestling and the unexpected turn of competition as athletes battle to win." Wonderful shot. And next we have feature photo. And the finalists are Rodrigo Abt of the Associated Press for Venezuela on the Edge. James Naktwe of Time for Rohingya. And Moises Salmon of Time for No Friends But the Mountains, What Life Looks Like for the Kurds of Syria Now That the U.S. Has Pulled Back. Congratulations all. The judges picked James Naktwe of Time for Rohingya. Congratulations, super, super work. They wrote, "Raise awareness. That's what powerful photography can do. These images take us to a place most of us can't visit, revealing Rohingya Muslims who are trying to cobble together a life as they are exiled to Bangladesh. This courageous photographer risked his well-being and safety to tell the world an important story." Thank you. And now for digital and interactive media. Our first category is multimedia interactive graphics and animation. And the finalists are Cynthia McFadden, Christine Romo, Lisa Cavazzuti, Rich Shapiro, Anna Brand, Jachuan Yu, and Robin Mukari of NBC News for Zone Rouge, An Army of Children Toils in African Mines.
These kids are helping satisfy the world's dependence on mica. Sometimes called a magic mineral, it's used in every car, every phone, and every plane because it doesn't overheat. It's estimated that more than 10,000 children work here in the mica mines. They earn pennies a day, if they're paid at all.
They don't have any money, they don't have any choice.
We meet this family of five. They live on less than $3 a week and one cup of rice a day.
Next, the staff of Newsday for Long Island Divided. And then Almudena Toral, Patricia Clarambeau, and Mauricio Rodriguez-Pons of Univision with Time and the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting for In El Salvador, Violence is Driving Girls to Kill Themselves.
En nuestro país, en El Salvador, a la niña le toca enfrentar muchísimos retos.
Son víctimas de acoso y abuso sexual, no solamente por pandillas, sino que por su misma condición de niñas.
Me sentía sola, me sentía desamparada.
Congratulations to all for incredibly important work. The judges picked Cynthia McFadden, Christine Romo, Lisa Cavazzuti, Rich Shapiro, Anna Brand, Jacquan Wu, and Robin Mukari of NBC News for Zone Rouge, An Army of Children Toils in African Mines. Congratulations, incredible report. The judges wrote, "NBC's investigation into the shocking abuse of children mining for a rare mineral essential for electronic devices is a testament to what journalism should do, inform, show the truth, hold the powerful accountable, and evoke change. This project used exceptional visual storytelling through never-before-seen video, photographs, aerial images, graphics, maps, and audio packaged together in a stunning presentation. This reporting has led to senators, organizations, and companies coming forward to enact changes against these horrific conditions. This report will help thousands of children live a better life. Extraordinary work. Now we go to digital innovation. And the first entry, Emily Cassie of the Marshall Project with the Guardian US for Detained. Then the staff of Newsday for Long Island Divided. And Brian Frescos of The Trace and The New Yorker for Easy Targets. Congratulations to all. Excellent work. The judges picked the staff of Newsday for Long Island Divided. Congratulations. Here's what they wrote. Long Island Divided prize behind the smiling facade of the real estate brokerage industry to expose how racial inequality pervades the housing market. Over the course of 3 years, the journalists conducted an extensive undercover operation, outfitting actors with hidden cameras to reveal the subtle daily injustices that directly contribute to residential segregation in America. Masterfully presented with a mix of interactive data visualizations, moving video testimonials, and responsive UI, user interfaces, this ambitious undertaking exemplifies how best to combine digital innovation with hard-nosed reporting to shine a light on a predicament that otherwise escapes scrutiny. Well done. Now we move on to radio and audio, and we have some short sound clips. First, we have radio or audio spot news reporting. We have only two finalists this year, the news team of WCBS AM for the Jersey shooting.
Six people are dead, including a police detective, after a barrage of gunfire in Jersey City this afternoon.
People here say it was absolute chaos, constant gunfire in the street for 20 minutes.
I just heard like 100 rounds back to back, vroom, 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 vroom.
Then we have Kevin Delaney of Westwood One for mass shootings in El Paso and Dayton.
Go, go, go! Special report, El Paso shopping center shooting. Gunfire from the shooting at the Walmart near Cielo Vista Mall in El Paso, Texas, as captured on cell phone video.
Shots fired!
Special report, mass shootings. I'm Christopher Cruz. At least 9 people have been killed in a shooting in Dayton, Ohio early this morning.
Congratulations to all. Winner this year is news team WCBS AM for the Jersey City shootings. Congratulations. Here's why the judges picked that one. They wrote, WCBS impressed the judges with strong local reporting and live coverage. Reporters took care to state the facts and keep listeners informed during every step of this shooting. The addition of field audio helped this reporting rise above the competitors. Congratulations. Now we have radio and audio feature reporting, and the finalists are Harry Siegel, Christina Greer, and Alexandra Lynn of FAQ NYC for talking about pictures.
There were a lot of female photojournalists back then. I mean, certainly it was a male-dominated profession, but I can absolutely say that I never felt that my gender prohibited me from doing any assignment. In fact, just the opposite. I mean, you know, Mike Lipak would treat us all equally. He cared about talent and what you brought back to the paper. He never judged you by your gender. He threw me everywhere. I shot everything.
Wendy Zuckerman, Meryl Horn, Rose Rimler, Caitlin Sorry, and Blythe Terrell of Gimlet Media for Science versus the Abortion Underground.
Carol had always assumed that the people doing illegal abortions like hers were mostly doctors. But then she found out that a lot of them didn't have any medical training. They were just randos out to make a quick buck. And so Carol starts thinking to herself, well, if these bozos can do it,
why don't we just do the abortions ourselves? You know,
I, a non-doctor, and my friends, who also were not doctors, we could do it ourselves.
And we have Carol Zimmer, Nick Chivata, and Jackson Bierfeldt of Now What? Joe Biden's Life Lessons.
He said, I'm going to be all right no matter what happens, Dad. He knew this was toward the end. He said, I'm going to be all right, Dad, but promise me, Dad. Promise me, Dad. You're going to be okay. Promise me. And I said, well, I'll be. He said, no, Dad. Give me your word as a Biden dad. You're going to be okay. You're going to be okay. And what he meant by that was he knew that our tendency, my tendency, would be to withdraw. And it wasn't about running, per se. It was about staying involved in the things I cared about my whole life.
Congratulations, all. The judges picked Harry Siegel, Christina Greer, and Alexandra Lynn of FAQ NYC for Talking About Pictures. Congratulations. Here's why they picked it. They wrote, if a picture is worth a thousand words, then Talking About Pictures certainly deserves the top prize. We loved listening to every minute of Susan Watts talk about her gritty and grimy and even sometimes scary New York photo assignments for the Daily News. From John Gotti to Gloria the Bronx prostitute and drug addict, Susan really captured New York in pictures, and every one of her pictures tells a great New York story. Congratulations. Moving on next to radio or audio investigative reporting. Again, the judges only picked two finalists. We have Seth Fried Wessler and Alyssa Escarce of Mother Jones, Latino USA, and Type Investigations for Marshall's Lawlessness.
The government is supposed to respond to these requests within a few weeks or months, but they weren't getting back to me. So I sued them.
Seth worked with a lawyer pro bono. They went before a federal judge in New York. And then finally, reluctantly, the marshals started to send him records.
It was mountains of documents. And they're still coming in. Government oversight reports and piles of records about medical care.
Next, the staff of ProPublica and WNYC for Trump Incorporated.
To your knowledge, was the president interested in reducing his local real estate bills, tax bills?
Yes.
And how did he do that?
What you do is you deflate the value of the asset, and then you put in a request to the tax department for a deduction.
Deflate, inflate. It's the Trump way. We have documents showing that from the Trump Organization's own tax filings. It might even have broken the law.
Congratulations to all. The judges picked Seth Fried Wessler and Alyssa Escarce of Mother Jones, Latino USA, and Type Investigations for Marshall's Lawlessness. Congratulations. Here's what they wrote. This year-long investigation into a detention system run by the U.S. Marshals exemplified everything that matters about investigative journalism. It put a human face to this little-known type of death in custody. The production quality and the craft were stunning. Congratulations. Now we have digital video, and digital video reporting is the first category. We have a team, Alexa Leotode, Casey Silvestri, Kevin Ergiles, James Serdam, and Jordan Malter of NBC News Now for Why Are There So Many More Crisis Pregnancy Centers Than Abortion Clinics?
The American Medical Association defines crisis pregnancy centers as organizations that try to reach women considering abortion, but they don't perform the procedure or give referrals. Around Pittsburgh, there are 14 CPCs versus just 3 abortion clinics. They vastly outnumber abortion providers on the national level too. Estimates for CPCs range from 2,500 to 4,000, whereas abortion providers hover around 1,671. So I wanted to know, why are there so many CPCs out there?
Next, Paul Moakley and Moises Saman of Time for When the News Hits Home.
I explained in an editorial this morning why I'm sort of taking the extraordinary step of putting down my reporter hat and talking to you all about this issue. On June 28th, I survived a mass shooting at the Capitol in Annapolis. Five of my colleagues were killed, and I was injured. I heard a pop, and I saw that our glass door was shattered, and I crouched under my desk. Everything fell silent until the police came and escorted us out. They instructed us to keep our eyes forward and step over Wendy's body.
And the third finalist, Almudena Torral, Patricia Clarambeau, Mauricio Rodriguez-Pons, Justine Simons, and Jose Osuna of Univision and Time for Extreme Violence is Driving Girls to Kill Themselves.
En nuestro país, en El Salvador, a la niña le toca enfrentar muchísimos retos.
Son víctimas de acoso y abuso sexual, no solamente por pandillas, sino que por su misma condición de niñas.
Me sentía sola, me sentía desamparada.
Congratulations to all for exceptional work. The judges picked Paul Moakley and Moises Saman of Time for When the News Hits Home. Congratulations. The judges wrote, "This powerful piece takes you inside the newsroom of the Capitol Gazette in Annapolis, Maryland, and dramatically explores the impact that the deadly 2018 shooting inside their office had on those who survived." The next category is television, and we have short video clips. First, national television feature. We have, as finalists, the staff of ABC News Nightline for Finding My Child.
Then, this recording, obtained by ProPublica from inside a detention facility. Outrage was swift.
Child internment camps, that's what I said.
We're signing an executive order. It's about keeping families together.
Just 2 days later, the controversial policy coming to an end. But the government had not tracked which parents and children belonged together, leaving the task of reuniting the families largely to NGOs.
Next, Lee Cowan, Sari Aviv, Remington Corper, and Rand Morrison of CBS Sunday Morning for Critical Condition.
Two hospitals closing for good, leaving
the causes are varied. The population in some of those towns has dwindled to a size that can't support a hospital anymore. In others, the hospitals are either mismanaged or they end up as table scraps in mega mergers. Medicaid expansion would have helped some stay open, Holmes says, but not all. And even so, reimbursement rates are often too low for hospitals to break even. Whatever the cause, the impact on the community is almost always the same.
And the staff of Spectrum News for Untangled, the Price of Progress.
These are the faces behind the headlines. Coal workers in limbo. Their employer, the mining company Black Jewel, declared bankruptcy. They didn't know if they had health insurance or what happened to their retirement accounts. And they just learned their last paychecks had bounced.
Congratulations to all for incredible work. The judges picked Lee Cowan, Sari Aviv, Remington Corper, and Rand Morrison of CBS Sunday Morning for Critical Condition. Congratulations. Here's why. They wrote, "CBS Sunday Morning's report, Critical Condition, exposes a critical issue facing rural America. Hospitals are closing, leaving millions of Americans with no access to medical care. Cowan uncovers the devastating consequences for patients and healthcare providers with masterful storytelling and in-depth reporting. And he illuminates innovative approaches that some are taking to survive." Moving on now to National Television Series or Investigative Reporting, the finalists are Mark Fainaru Wada, Mike Kessler, Greg Amante, Tonya Malinowski, and Mike Drago of ESPN for The Squad, 44 years, 41 allegations.
How does a man allegedly molest countless boys and young men over five decades and two continents and get away with it?
Conrad was masterful.
Maniacally brilliant.
Deceptive.
Incredibly manipulative. A serial sex offender.
Mr. Van Wang, my name is Mark Fainaru Wada. I'm a reporter at ESPN.
Next, Cynthia McFadden, Connor Ferguson, Shanshan Dong, and Richard Shapiro of NBC News for Marijuana Vaping Investigation.
CannaSafe tested seven THC cartridges from licensed dispensaries and six from the black market.
The illicit carts had the most dangerous stuff in it at much higher levels, and that dangerous stuff we found ended up being formaldehyde, other carcinogens, and carbon monoxide, and of course, hydrogen cyanide.
That's right, cyanide. Not one of them was safe for consumption. Fair?
That's very fair to say. Every single one of them had something. You know, some of them had a cocktail of things that were wrong with them.
And the third finalist is Cynthia McFadden again with Christine Romo, Lisa Cavazzuti, and Bill Angelucci of NBC News for Zone Rouge, An Army of Children Toils in African Mines.
These kids are helping satisfy the world's dependence on mica. Sometimes called a magic mineral, it's used in every car, every phone, and every plane because it doesn't overheat. It's estimated that more than 10,000 children work here in the mica mines. They earn pennies a day if they're paid at all.
They don't have any money, they don't have any choice.
We meet this family of five. They live on less than $3 a week and one cup of rice a day.
Congratulations to all. The judges picked Cynthia McFadden, Christine Romo, Lisa Cavazzuti, and Bill Angelucci of NBC News for Zone Rouge, An Army of Children Toils in African Mines. Congratulations once again for an extraordinary report. This panel of judges wrote, Cynthia McFadden and her production team at NBC News masterfully report on young children who are digging for mica in Madagascar to provide this magic mineral to electronics industries around the world and ultimately to the United States. Yet, as those industries earn billions of dollars in profits, the children are struggling to survive. McFadden's story exemplifies excellence in journalism. Congratulations. Next, we move on to National Television Spot News reporting. And we have, as finalists, the staff of ABC News for El Paso shooting.
Gunshot, one shot hurt.
The first call of an active shooter coming at 10 o'clock this morning at the Cielo Vista Mall in El Paso, Texas. The store packed with morning shoppers.
All pack units, investigative units, please make it to the west side of Walmart, please.
Witnesses say a man wearing cargo pants and carrying a rifle begins shooting as he makes his way through the parking lot and into the store.
Also, the staff of ABC News again for Notre Dame Inferno.
Will the spire of the Notre Dame Cathedral, we have just witnessed collapsing amid those flames and the smoke pouring from the top of that iconic theater. That is that will take your breath away looking at that. Again, this 12th century cathedral, as we all know, famously, the Seine right beneath it. So many people, Americans included, have traveled from all over the world to see Notre Dame.
And Patrick Upman and Jake Tapper of CNN, the lead with Jake Tapper, for Hurricane Dorian devastates the Bahamas.
What's going on?
Yeah, we're trying to do the rescue here in Freeport after the hurricane.
How many people are out there still?
A few hundred.
Few hundred.
Yeah, a lot of homes are over here.
And it's tough to get out there and get them.
It's tough.
How long are you going to keep doing it?
Until we get everybody. We Bahamians. We're not going to stop until we get everybody in.
Congratulations to all. The judges picked Patrick Upman and Jake Tapper of CNN, the lead with Jake Tapper, for Hurricane Dorian Devastates the Bahamas. Congratulations, here's what the judges wrote. Hurricane coverage on television can often come across as cliche, but this coverage is a model for how to do it right. CNN covers the storm from all angles and provides solid documentation of the devastation. The on-scene reporting is non-sensational, and the coverage is compassionate. Nicely done. And we move on now to local television feature. Finalists, Lisha Majdan, Dan Keese, Christy Lee Neuberger, and Dan Komoranitz of Spectrum News New York 1 for The Keeper of the Flame.
Many of the maintenance people were middle-aged veterans. None of them wanted to go up to the torch. So I went up to the torch, and I started to clean up there. I took care of the interior superstructure, the iron skeleton that holds the statue together. I cleaned the girders, changed the lights out there. So I felt I was the quasi-mode. I was like the complete caretaker. I felt like I was on top of the mountain.
Next, Lisha Majdan, Dan Keese again, and Pat Kiernan of Spectrum News, New York 1, for Margaret and Helene.
Slowly, slowly, slowly.
But it's all business when they're running breakfast and lunch service at the senior center.
Thank you. Come on.
The two are there every day, starting at 6 a.m. Margaret and Helene prep the food, they clean the tables, and then help to serve nearly 200 seniors who stop by for a bite to eat.
Hi, honey. How are you?
And on Mondays?
Good afternoon.
They organize bingo.
Oh, 64.
And the staff of Spectrum News New York 1 for Street Level Victory Boulevard. Congratulations to all. The judges picked the staff of Spectrum News New York 1 for Street Level Victory Boulevard. Congratulations. Here's why they picked it. They said, beautiful visuals, fascinating story, great characters, so well written and edited. Makes me want to go there immediately, visit the museum, and find a restaurant. Bravo. And now we have local news, series, or investigative reporting. And the first finalist is Karen Atonito, Anthony Coco, and Walt Kane of News 12 New Jersey's Kane in Your Corner for Bullied in School.
School bullying must be motivated by an actual or perceived characteristic, like race or gender, or by any other distinguishing characteristic. Two former heads of the anti-bullying task force say they were hoping that would protect everyone.
If they're heavy, if they wear glasses, I mean, there's so many distinguishing characteristics that we can talk about.
It's any characteristic that you can identify that had that child targeted.
But we reviewed hundreds of cases and found that's often not how it works.
Next, Bobby Cousa, Chanel Dawson, and Dan Komoranitz of Spectrum News New York 1 for Looking to London, a roadmap for congestion pricing.
Simon Dixon worked for years on the congestion charge, which covers about 8 square miles of central London, close in size to the future congestion zone in Manhattan. Every driver is charged £11.50, or about $15, upon entering the zone anytime between 7 a.m. and 6 p.m. Drivers can then leave and re-enter without any further charge.
As cars enter the congestion zone, there are no toll gates or any other real visible infrastructure, just signage and lots of cameras.
And the third finalist, Courtney Gross, Dan Keese, and Dan Komoranitz of Spectrum News New York 1 for Out of Service. New York 1 investigation finds chronic elevator outages plague NYCHA.
New York One exclusively obtained a year's worth of elevator outage records from the New York City Housing Authority. We found out between 2012 and 2018, the number of elevator outages climbed by more than 16%, from almost 38,000 in 2012 to to more than 44,000 last year. That's about 121 breakdowns a day for a system that houses roughly 400,000 New Yorkers.
Congratulations to all. The judges picked Karen Antonito, Anthony Coca, and Walt Kane for News 12 New Jersey's Kane in Your Corner for Bullied in School. Congratulations. Here's why they picked it. They wrote, Kane dives deep into a topic that is affecting many of our children. This is a piece of prime investigative reporting showing how New Jersey leads the nation in bullying and attempts to combat the problem are all smoke and mirrors. Through interviews with a variety of experts and sifting through legal documents to show how this problem is being ignored, he confronts officials and brings the story home through his sympathetic treatment of victims. Well done. Next, we have local television news spot reporting. And the finalists are, again, the staff of Spectrum News New York 1 for Midtown Helicopter Crash.
Helicopter made an emergency landing on the top of, it's hard to see what it looks like at the top of the building because there is so much fog, so much rain. It's hard to see it. There's also pedestrians, tourists walking around trying to take photos, asking questions, wondering what is going on. Many people looking scared and freaked out to see such a scene here on the ground right in Midtown Manhattan, which is, of course, a very busy area. And something that was mentioned by officials was that there's no indication that terrorism is the case for this incident. It seems it was either a hard landing or emergency crash.
Next again, Spectrum News, New York 1, for the firing of Officer Daniel Pantaleo.
It is clear that Daniel Pantaleo can no longer effectively serve as a New York City police officer.
All right, there it is. Police Commissioner James O'Neill has decided to fire Daniel Pantaleo for his role in the death of Eric Garner 5 years ago. He made it quite clear this was an extremely difficult decision for him. He weighed both sides very carefully. He took about 10 minutes or so to explain the pros and cons of the decision, and he said it required fairness and impartiality.
And the third one, Amy Morris, Steve Bogner, Adam Cooperstein, Eddie Alonzo, and Jonathan Dientz of WNBC for Jersey City Shootout.
Show you how close we are to the situation. That police tape is less than 2 blocks away from the bodega where law enforcement sources tell us one officer was shot in the head as in now critical condition. This is inside a bodega where a man and a woman, according to our sources, are holed up inside in some sort of standoff situation. And you can see ambulance, SWAT teams, federal, state officials here, and the response is growing by the minute. We have not heard gunshots now in the last minute or two.
Congratulations to all. The judges picked Amy Morris, Stephen Bogner, Adam Cooperstein, Eddie Alonzo, and Jonathan Dienst of WNBC for Jersey City Shootout. And here's what they wrote. The WNBC news team confronted a harrowing situation with on-scene reporting that was highly informative and non-sensational. This team of reporters also conducted person-on-the-street interviews with meaning. We too often hear such POS that lacks this kind of substance. Well done. Well done. And now for our final four awards. They're big ones. First, we have the Daniel Pearl Prize for Investigative Reporting, named for the Asia Bureau Chief of the Wall Street Journal, who was captured and beheaded while covering news about terrorism in Pakistan. The finalists are Michael H. Keller, Gabrielle J.X. Dance, and Nellie Bowles of the New York Times for Exploited. Dan Levine, Benjamin Lesser, Jamie Dowdell, Lisa Girion, and Michelle Conlon of Reuters for Hidden Injustice. The Wall Street Journal for How Amazon Puts Us at Risk. Congratulations to all. Phenomenal reporting. The award goes to the staff of the Wall Street Journal for how Amazon puts us at risk. Congratulations. The judges said, the Wall Street Journal's How Amazon Puts Us at Risk documented in detail how the nation's largest internet marketplace failed to protect its users from unsafe products. The journal's investigative team's research extended even to dumpster diving for trash and garbage to offer for sale. The series prompted Amazon to adopt policies to ban items ranging from dangerous toys to garments produced under unsafe conditions in Bangladesh. Very well done. Congratulations. These next three awards are omnibus awards, open to all media, print, electronic, whatever. And the first one is the Mosaic Award, which recognizes coverage of disability, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender identity, social justice, equity, and inclusion. And the finalists are the staff of ABC News Nightline for Am I Next? The next is Wayne Drace of ESPN.com for Rob Mendez. And the third is Geraldine Seeley, Eli Hagar, Jennifer Toon, Sergio Hill, and Daniel Adams of the Marshall Project for Life Inside Forever. Congratulations to all. Superb work. The judges picked ABC News Nightline for Am I Next? Congratulations, and here's why they picked it. They said, Nightline's riveting series stood out to Deadline Club judges who unanimously selected the series for this year's Mosaic Award. The judging committee especially appreciated the time, effort, and vulnerability required of these reporters in order to earn their sources' trust, and how sensitive these reporters were to their sources' concerns, including young trans women of color who feared for their lives after seeing their friends murdered. This package is a significant contribution toward greater awareness of the grave dangers faced by LGBTQ communities here and abroad, from America's epidemic of violence against trans women of color to the experiences of LGBTQ Chechens trying to live in a repressive police state where gay men have been subjected to beatings, electrocution, and torture. Next, we have the Less Pain Award for coverage on communities of color. And this award honors the memory of legendary journalist and the club's New York Journalism Hall of Famer, Less Pain. And it recognizes coverage on topics and issues specifically relevant to communities of color. The finalists this year are Oliver Laughlin and Jamiles Larty of The Guardian US for Cancer Town. The staff of Newsday for Long Island Divided. And Sarah Riley, Jeremy Singervine, and Sean Campbell of The Trace and BuzzFeed News for Free to Shoot Again. Congratulations to all. Superb work. The judges picked Sarah Riley, Jeremy Singervine, and Sean Campbell of The Trace and BuzzFeed News for Free to Shoot Again. Congratulations. Here's why. They said, The Trace and BuzzFeed News captured the essence of the Less Pain Award through their use of data, investigative reporting, and poignant interviews to reveal racial disparities in the arrest of shooting suspects, ultimately leading to change in Baltimore's police investigative practices and to the retrial and freedom of one man. Well done. And finally, our Public Service Award. The finalists are Andrew Ford of Adbury Park Press for Policing the Police, Exposing Deadly Chases, Lying Cops, and Gender Discrimination in New Jersey Law Enforcement. Next, the staff of the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists, The Intercept, NBC News, Univision, WNYC, and Latin American media partners for Solitary Voices. And finally, Newsday, the staff of Newsday for Long Island Divided. Congratulations to all. The judges picked the staff of Newsday for Long Island Divided. Congratulations, finalists before and one in another category, and there's a reason for it. Here's what the judges said. Newsday's three-year hidden camera investigation, Long Island Divided, delivered devastating proof of the kind of pernicious discrimination that goes on when people think no one is watching. Rather than just tell, it actually showed us the widespread differences in how Long Island real estate agents treated whites and minorities, most frequently African Americans, steering them to entirely different communities and reinforcing one of the most segregated suburban regions in the country. Newsday's findings got national attention and generated federal and state action almost immediately, showing the power a newspaper can have when it makes an extraordinary commitment to uncover a form of bias many had long suspected but felt was impossible to prove. Well, what a collection of incredible work. I am very proud to have been here to honor all of it and you talented, hardworking, dedicated seekers of the truth who pulled all of these stories together. This is what keeps government, businesses, and all kinds of organizations, big and small, honest, doing the job that they were meant to do. You know, your job as watchdog is critically important, especially for the functioning of a democracy. Don't you forget it, please. Now, a word about a special housekeeping note. For those of you especially honored with a Rube statuette this year, because of the pandemic, they will be held for you at the Salmagundi Club. That's 47 Fifth Avenue in Manhattan. And they will be available for pickup during their regular office hours, which are Tuesday to Friday, 1 to 6 p.m., and Saturday and Sunday, 1 to 5 p.m. There is only, I might add, there's only one Rube issued per category. So if you have a team of people on it, additional statuettes for team members can be ordered. Winners will be notified how to do that separately. Now then, a special word of thanks. We want to thank all who helped put this program together. It's a lot of work. First of all, special thanks to Father Carl Turner and St. Thomas Church, Fifth Avenue, for allowing us to record in this beautiful space. Special thanks also to the many, many judges who gave of their time to carefully evaluate the 689 entries that we had in the awards program this year. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And a big thanks to the awards program team, led by Chairman Colin DeVries, Rebecca Castillo, James Martinez, George Bodarkey, John Long, Katina Perron, Daniel Roberts, Trisha Couture, Emma Silikens, Peter Seke, and Club President Claire Regan. Thank you all for a great job under extremely challenging circumstances of this pandemic. As for you first-rate journalists watching, just go out. Create more great work that makes a difference in lives like you did this year so we can honor you again next year. And we thank all of the rest of you for watching. Good night.